And welcome to the 8th meeting of the Economy, Jobs and Fair Work Committee. First of all, there is item 1 on the agenda, which is a decision to take business in private relating to items 4, 5 and 6 on the agenda. Is the committee happy to take these matters in private?
Yes.
Thank you. The second item on the agenda is the question of witness expenses for the inquiry we're doing on the economic impact of leaving the European Union. Is the committee happy to delegate these to myself as convener under the usual terms?
Yes.
Thank you. We'll then move to item 3 on the agenda, which is the Audit Scotland report supporting Scotland's economic growth. We have, I think, three guests this morning, Fraser McKinley, Anthony Clark, and Gemma Davidson from
Diamond.
Beg your pardon. I've been to the optician but not managed to get my new glasses yet. Apologies for that. So we'll commence by taking evidence from them. And I would invite, first of all, Audit Scotland, whichever one of you is tasked to do the opening 5-minute statement.
I'll kick off with a very short opening and statement. And good morning, members. Thank you very much for giving us the opportunity to brief you today on the Auditor General's report on supporting Scotland's economic growth, which we published back in July. As you know, the report focuses on the roles of Scottish enterprise and Highlands and Islands enterprise, but takes us at starting point, the Scottish Government's economic strategy, as this is what determines the strategies and plans for the enterprise bodies. First of all, convener, it's important to say that we recognise that supporting economic growth is not a straightforward or easy task. It is complex. There are many factors involved which are out with the direct control and responsibility of any government, in fact, never mind just Scotland. So we understand that it is not easy, but we also understand its importance. The economic strategy that the government has set out is a high-level document, setting out the broad approach to help achieve the overall purpose of sustainable economic growth. However, we found in the report that the government does not set out in the strategy or indeed elsewhere how the various economic policies and initiatives will be implemented. It's important that the government's clear about how it's to achieve its ambition of sustainable economic growth. In that sense, we think the how is as important as the what. The context for supporting economic growth is continuously changing, and public sector economic strategies and interventions have to respond to and be appropriate for the economic climate. And as you'll know better than I do, we have been through quite a period of late, and there is more to come with new financial powers for the Scottish Parliament and, of course, the result of the EU referendum back in June. And all these things and others will clearly influence how the Scottish Government and Scotland supports economic growth in future. Taking all this into account, the report recommends that the Scottish Government could strengthen its approach to developing, delivering and monitoring its economic strategy. This includes developing clear timescales and actions and setting out specific responsibilities for the public sector bodies involved. On the whole, we found that Scottish Enterprise and Highlands and Islands Enterprise are performing well. Their business plans and activities are based on a wide range of evidence, and each of the bodies has a good understanding of how to respond to opportunities and challenges in their respective areas. As ever, as auditors convener, we also found some areas for improvement. For example, both bodies offer some similar support, which is tailored to the needs of their customers and environment, but there are many different arrangements for delivering this support, and the rationale for that isn't always clear. We found that there is some scope to deliver some activities, such as their support to the growth sectors, more efficiently. And in addition, although we find that the enterprise bodies are performing well against their individual performance measures, it's much more difficult to measure their contribution to the national outcomes in the national performance framework. It's important, again, that the government understands the contribution that the enterprise bodies are making, both individually and collectively, to both its economic strategy and the economic growth targets. Finally, convener, the committee will be aware that the Scottish Government has been undertaking a review of the skills and enterprise agencies. In fact, I understand that the first stage of that will be published imminently. So we don't know what that's going to say yet, but we do say, and we said back in July, that we think that review offers a great opportunity to to address some of the issues identified in our report. And with that, Convener Anthony Gemma and I are very happy to answer any questions the committee has.
Thank you very much. May I start, first of all, just by asking a couple of general questions. In your report, you've got key messages that you've set out at the start. One of these relates to performance and performance measures. Now, I think what you say in paragraph 3 on page 5 of your summary at the outset of your report is that the NPF measures progress towards economic targets and outcomes, but it does not measure the contribution of policies and initiatives to delivering these outcomes. And I think you've highlighted in the report different standards of measuring performance amongst the different bodies and as compared to the Scottish Government's or the NPF, which you refer to there. Are there other performance measures used by other UK public bodies which could be used to assess the criteria applied in Scotland on performance, which you could tell us about, that might be useful?
I'll kick off, Convener, and then ask the team to come in with a bit more detail. I mean, I think it's fair to say that, first of all, Scotland is, if you like, ahead of the game in terms of having a national performance framework and an outcomes-based approach. So it's not always easy to find strong comparators in other parts of the UK. Northern Ireland are just beginning that journey. They're consulting on a wellbeing framework, and Wales are getting there too. So it's difficult to find things that are exactly comparable. We do use the example of Northern Ireland in the report, specifically around the economy, as what we would see as good practice in the area. I might just ask Gemma to say a little bit about that, if that's okay.
Certainly. That was with regards to the economic strategy. What we say in the report about the economic strategy is that Scotland's economic strategy doesn't really break down into actions and timescales, so it's very hard to see actually what will be delivered and when will it be delivered by, so that it allows for that review of progress to be made. And there were certain elements of what Northern Ireland do around that in terms of having a clear action plan and detailing which public bodies are responsible for delivering those actions and the timescales, that we thought might be interesting for the Scottish Government to look at to see if they could replicate some of that. In terms of the performance measures, as Fraser was saying, because Scotland has essentially been leading the way with an outcomes framework, it is quite difficult to find those kind of comparative measures. I think what I would say is that the enterprise agencies do have a lot of performance measures. They do measure their performance a lot. They have a lot that they look at as part of running the business. They publish a lot. What we can't see, however, is what they're measuring and what contribution that makes to the national performance framework. So, is their success in meeting those performance measures actually making any difference to these national outcomes? And what we would like to see is more of, I suppose, a step-by-step process as to kind of how do these outcomes build up? So what is actually going to make the difference? Which of the agencies are contributing to these national outcomes? And what is, if that outcome moves, what is it that's made the difference? Which agency or what partnership has actually made that difference? And that's what we can't see at the moment.
Is that what you refer to when you're looking at recommendations on the following page at development of clear targets, timescales and actions, and then monitoring and reporting progress against those targets and actions? And is that what you specifically identify as lacking?
That was when we looked at the economic strategy, absolutely, is that kind of breaking it down so that the economic strategy is a very wide-ranging, high-level document, and what we really kind of wanted to see was that kind of underlying detail as to how to make that strategy operational. So what does it mean for the public bodies? What actions do they need to undertake? Who's actually going to do that? When will it be done by? So that you can then review progress against that. And that, again, will make it easier for saying, actually, how do we measure the performance? So you know, once we know what the individual bodies have to achieve and by when, and what is the performance target around that, what does that actually mean in terms of performance?
So the detail is lacking, and whose responsibility would you say is it to set this in motion to get that specific difficulty or problem dealt with?
So I think the government, in terms of the measuring the contribution to the National Performance Framework. I think that's the government, obviously working closely with particularly two enterprise bodies, but the other partners that are involved. And I think the other part of that recommendation that you highlight, Convener, that we think is really important is better understanding the money and how much is spent on this. We had a go at estimating the amount of money, and we focused on the 2 billion or thereabouts spent by the strategic partners. It's really important that government understands if that is indeed the amount that they would recognise as being directly contributing to supporting economic growth, and assessing whether that's being spent in the right way and in the right places to ensure that the outcomes are being delivered.
And perhaps finally from me at this stage, before I open up to other members of the committee, you talk about, in your recommendations, routinely reviewing the economic strategy to ensure it remains relevant and fit for purpose. What are the sort of timeframes that you're talking about there?
The timeframes for review, Convener?
Yes. Does it depend on the area involved?
Yeah, I mean, I think one of the things we found was that while the economic strategy has changed and evolved over the years, and its most recent iteration was 2015, when we came along to look at the process of review, it was difficult to see that kind of clear and transparent and systematic process that said, so what were we trying to achieve? How have we done against that? What's happening in the world? What does that mean for how we want to change our objectives in the future? So it's that kind of systematic process of review, I think, that we didn't really find much evidence for that we think is really important. So it's not for us to comment on whether the economic strategy or the growth sectors are right or wrong. What we're looking for is evidence of government and the agencies taking a considered approach to ensure that indeed they are continuing to be the right things. And I was reading with interest the official report from your last session on Fair Work. And one of the new elements of the strategy last year is around inclusive growth. And so I think there's an interesting question in there about, well, what is the role of Scottish Enterprise and Highlands and Islands Enterprise in the agenda around Fair Work? And are we confident? Have we gone through a process that ensures that they're clear what their role is and that we have measures in place to make sure that indeed they are contributing to that agenda and that we can measure that contribution? So in terms of timescales, I mean, I think it would depend. I'm not suggesting that they have to do it every year, every 2 years. I don't think it's for us to come up with that kind of, you know, rigid approach. And they will be reviewing these things on an ongoing basis. But it does seem to me that given the degree of change that there has been in not just Scotland, but UK, Europe, the global economy over the last wee while, we might have expected to see more evidence of a more systematic review process.
Thank you. John Mason.
Thanks, Convener. Good morning. I mean, I suppose, over the years read a number of Audit Scotland reports on a whole range of subjects. I mean, this one seems quite positive in that there don't seem to be huge problems arising, whereas I've seen other reports where there were huge problems arising. Is that a fair comment? Or?
Yeah, that's absolutely fair, Mr. Mason, I think. As you say, this is one where we recognise lots of good work that's happening. And I think it's particularly in relation to the job the two enterprise agencies are doing. They do their job well. They take it very seriously. They measure how they're doing, and they're able to account for the money that they're spending. So our area for improvement really is at that higher level, about looking more widely and assessing better the contribution of those agencies and others to the national outcomes.
I mean, this whole question of the National Performance Framework and tying the detail into the National Performance Framework, if I'm not mistaken, is a kind of wide problem. It's not just to do with the Scottish Enterprise and Highlands and Islands Enterprise. I think it's come up in the budget quite a lot that, you know, how do you tie a budget figure into the big picture? Well, you're kind of nodding, so I guess that is the case. I mean, is there an answer to that, or is it just one of these problems that doesn't go away?
Well, so I would absolutely agree with that. I think it's something that we all need to keep working at. I mean, you could argue that the government, having agreed an outcomes approach when it became the government back in 2007, chose a difficult route to take. It is harder to do it this way. If we only continued to measure inputs and outputs, that's an easier way to do it. But as a result of that, we will continue to kind of challenge and push and expect more to ensure that if we're setting outcomes in whatever area it is, be it health or social care or the economy or the environment, that it's reasonable for us to expect clear plans and activities and measures to be in place about how they're being measured over time. Outcomes, we understand and accept the fact that outcomes are by definition delivered in the long term. Some can be 10, 20, 30 years. And because of that, it's even more important to know how you're doing. So where would you expect to be in year 3, 5, 10 as you're making progress towards the outcome? And that's the bit that we quite often in lots of our work see lacking.
Okay, thank you. Now, another issue that came up once or twice in the report is the whole thing about what Scottish Enterprise do and what HIE do, and is there duplication, and why does one lead and one not lead? And particularly, I was looking at paragraph 79 on page 32, which talks about it's not clear why some forms of support are delivered jointly or on behalf of the other, and it says there are historical reasons. I just wondered if you could maybe give examples of that or tease it out a bit. I mean, it seems to me that, for example, on community broadband, it's mainly a rural issue, not entirely a rural issue. Therefore, it would seem pretty logical that HIE lead on that. So I don't know if that's written down somewhere, but it seems kind of logical to me. Are there other examples where there's a problem or an issue?
So you're absolutely right to highlight paragraph 79. And in fact, the two previous paragraphs highlight some of the areas where it is a bit clearer. To be fair, where there is better rationale for why Scottish Enterprise and HIE lead on some things. But I'll maybe ask Anthony just to say a little bit about the areas where maybe it's not quite so clear.
I think the areas where I've identified a degree of duplication is where Scottish Enterprise and Highlands and Enterprise have specialist teams for growth sectors. So they're both working across the growth sectors. And we've also identified areas of potential duplication to do with support for particular industries as well, where they're developing training advice and supporting that way. So there are issues at national level in terms of potential areas of duplication between the two bodies.
The whole point of having the two bodies was that one would concentrate in the Highlands and Islands with its low population and different challenges. So presumably, you know, any business, even if they're doing a similar thing, even if they're growing, is going to face different challenges in the Highlands and Islands than they would in Glasgow or Edinburgh.
Indeed, but if you look at paragraph 80, we highlight some of the areas there. So research and analysis at a national level is done by both bodies. Obviously, they may have a particular emphasis on either the Lowland Scotland or the Highland Scotland, but we've also identified sector strategies as being areas where there's an element of duplication between HIE and SE2. So it's quite possible that one of those bodies could take a lead with a bit of support from the other, but at the moment it looks as though there are areas of overlap and duplication.
I don't know, some of my colleagues might want to come in on that one. I think the last area I wanted to touch on, it was, again, there was mentioned a couple of places, for example, in case study 3, which is on page 41, I think, about the whole issue of exiting and, you know, kind of ceasing support for a business. Now, I suppose I'd kind of felt, from my experience with Scottish Enterprise especially, that if a business kept growing, then they would keep needing or should have Scottish Enterprise support because they keep on growing, which is what we'd like. But there's a kind of a suggestion that maybe it should be more for a fixed term and there should be more of an exit. So do you think we should be looking for or expecting more exits?
I think this is a... Where are we getting the biggest bang for our buck question, Mr. Mason? I think it's about absolutely recognising as a business is starting up and growing, they're going to need some support. But at what point, even if it's continuing to grow, can we expect it to not require public support on the basis that there's an opportunity cost to that if we're continuing to support business X over here, which is well established and continuing to grow and be successful? That's money that's not being spent somewhere else. So it's not an easy fix. There's always going to be a judgment in there, which will be based on a whole range of factors, and our sense is that both agencies are actually quite sophisticated at that. There was equally, though, a couple of bits of evidence from supported companies who were kind of saying, actually, we're not sure why we're still an account managed business. And if they're saying that, then that does suggest to us that at least it's worth asking the question that there might be a set of criteria that you would recognise a point at which Scottish Enterprise or HIE say, actually, you're kind of on your own now and we're going to exit and invest that support and time somewhere else.
And then what
potentially come back in if either the business hit problems or it was going into some kind of new growth phase or something like that?
Potentially, and at some point they maybe just decide that that it's not to be supported by the public sector. I mean, I think it's important to remember that the whole point of having state agencies involved in economic growth is to get involved in the higher risk activity. In a sense, they deal with market failure, so the stuff that the market isn't supporting is where you would expect these agencies to be operating. So there is inherently a higher degree of risk, and therefore I think the agencies do and should continue to ask themselves the question, is it right to be continuing to focus our time and attention and scarce public resource on businesses maybe that are well established and have grown, as opposed to supporting others that might need a bit more help early on. So it's about, again, just a clarity and having a rationale for those things, rather than, it's kind of similar to your question earlier about why some things have been done the way they are. Some people were saying, well, it's IBEEN. It's that kind of, well, it's just always been that way. And I think what we're saying is, well, it's worth checking.
Thank you so much.
Thank you. Jackie Bailey.
I've spent a good deal of time since the economic strategy was first published asking for action plans and measurement frameworks, so this is very welcome indeed. Is there any evidence that the government, between publication of its economic strategy and the report before us today, has taken any action to improve that monitoring framework or indeed produced any kind of action plan?
So I think that the report as it stands, as we published it in July, is that we couldn't find what we would expect to see in terms of a plan, certainly for the 2015 new strategy that says this is how this is going to be implemented. I think there's an interesting debate, and we had the debate with government often in the process of this report, as you can imagine, about what we're expecting. And sometimes I think people think, as auditors, we are being a bit simplistic about that, which is why I was keen to emphasise that we understand the complexity of this. And equally, I think it's legitimate for us to say, if you're setting out four ambitious outcomes around now the four I's as they're known, then it's reasonable for us to say, well, how are you going to do that? And how are you going to know if you're on target? And what is the role of the bodies that are involved in it? And how is the 2.2 billion or whatever the number is being used for that? So, as I say, we are hopeful that the current review will capture some of this. The timing in that sense was good, because around about the same time as this, we also published some reports on higher education and colleges and some other of the bodies that are involved in the review. So we're waiting with real interest to see what comes out the review, both in its first phase and then later on how they're actually going to implement it. But as far as we can tell, the story that we present in the report is the story as it stands.
So what would you like to see in that review? Certainly we too are anticipating something being produced imminently. Given what you've said, that this is a great opportunity to address some of these issues, what are the two or three things, headline things, you would expect to see in that review?
So I think for me, something about, as we say in the recommendations, a more detailed plan, if you like, for how the economic strategy and other strategies related to the skills and enterprise agencies are going to be delivered. Importantly, something about the way in which those agencies work together. My understanding is that the review's been focusing on not so much the individual organisations, but how they work together and the system of support that they provide. So I think it's important that that's clear and well set out. And if there is any question, I have to say, about the role of individual bodies, whether it be SE or High or the Funding Council, for example, that they take the opportunity to do that too. It would seem like a bit of a missed opportunity to do a review of these agencies if they don't also take the chance to look at the agencies individually. In our Colleges Overview report that we published earlier in the year, we had a specific recommendation about looking at the role of the Scottish Funding Council, which hasn't really been looked at fundamentally in kind of 10 years plus. And it would seem a good opportunity to do that. So if I were to pick two or three, those would be them, I think.
Look out for those. I wonder whether I could focus on two, what I think are quite key economic issues facing Scotland. Firstly, we've got the slowdown in economic growth. Secondly, and you comment on this in the opening to your report, the underperforming of the Scottish economy comparative to the UK economy. And I think the numbers you quoted were GDP in Scotland was 6.8% since 2012, but 8.8% across the UK over the same time period. If one was to level criticism at Audit Scotland, and of course don't want to do so, but nevertheless I have a question. Why was there no commentary? Why wasn't this something that was considered by Audit Scotland when looking at what Scottish Enterprise and High's purpose was? You know, there's no commentary about what they're doing to close that gap or indeed to improve economic growth in light of a slowdown.
It's a very fair question, and the scope of this audit was something that we grappled with because it could be very, very big. And so what we didn't do was set out to do an audit on the performance of the Scottish economy, primarily because that's not our job, and nor are we best placed to do it. I think there are lots of other people better placed to do it, and we were particularly keen to focus on the agencies because we hadn't looked at the agencies for quite a long time. In a sense, though, I think what we're trying to say in the report is that the discussion we started off with the convener about making the link between the role of the economic agencies and what the government is trying to achieve at a national level is, in a sense, the point you're making, I think, which is you can't tell. So you can make some assessment of how they're performing as organisations in their own right, and those organisations do make an effort to link those to the national outcomes, but it is very difficult to assess the contribution and the role of the economic agencies to the performance of the Scottish economy. In the context, as I said right at the start, is of course there's lots of other things that are impacting on the performance of the Scottish economy. So there's always an element of needing to be realistic about what government enterprise agencies can do in that context.
I wasn't asking you to make an assessment of the Scottish economy, and I think you know that. It is the two principal agencies charged with developing the economy that I was asking for an assessment of and their contribution to closing that gap. Are you saying to me you didn't have the information available to enable that assessment to be made and therefore the government doesn't either?
I mean, I think the core point in our report is it's hard to make that assessment of the contribution of those agencies and others involved in economic growth to the successful delivery of the outcomes. As I say, bearing in mind that there are lots of other things that aren't within the direct influence or control of the government that impact on the performance of the economy.
One final question, convener, if I may. Mackay Consultants have been in touch with us to suggest that, you know, whilst the case studies are all interesting and informative, they really have not been subject to any objective analysis or commentary. How would you respond to that?
So, first thing to say is we absolutely welcome that kind of engagement with people, with Mackay Consultants and indeed other people that have been in touch. The case studies we did really to provide a bit of colour and flavour to what otherwise might have been quite a dry subject. I think it's important to give some real life stuff. So we didn't, in a sense, ever set out to do an audit of them. We were just giving a flavour of the kinds of things that were out there, and absolutely recognise that, and we know not just Mackay Consultants, but other people have been in touch to say that they either agree with them or they really don't. And I think that's something that you find in this area, is that it's genuinely very important to people, and people have very strong views about it. And we absolutely welcome that. We like the fact that if we publish a report, people engage with it. It's we're more concerned if nobody notices.
Thank you. Gil Patterson.
Can I ask a general question, first of all, and then I'll come on to a couple of particular questions relating to the question I'm going to ask. In the short existence of this committee, this new committee, what bedevils this committee, and I think it's come up at every single session since it's been formed this term, the question of stats peculiar to Scotland. We just can't find them. So, and we know they exist because I've got a colleague sitting across from there and myself, that we've been contributing to these stats, some of them minor stats, but some of them really, really crucial, not only to the run of business in Scotland, but to the Scottish economy. So they're there, but we just can't get our hands on them. So my question to you is, what's the source for your stats, and can we get a hold of them so that we can interrogate these stats? I think it would help us immensely.
I mean, you're absolutely right to raise that question, and we, in fact, I think Dave Watson at your last session called us the best number crunchers we have. So I was pleased to see that. And that obviously is a big chunk of our work, and very often we find it hard to make conclusions based on the data that's available, for sure. I'll ask Gemma to say a little bit about the specifics of this. What I would say in general terms, though, is we are very conscious of that. We are, as an organisation, more widely convener, very keen to make publicly available all the data we have. So we've started routinely now publishing not just the reports, but the data that underpins the reports. And there's a bit of software called Tableau, which allows you to interrogate data in quite an interesting way, depending on region and all sorts of stuff. So we're very keen to do that so that people can do their own analysis to help with that engagement that we were talking about a second ago. Gemma, do you want to say a wee bit about the specifics of...
Yeah, certainly. I mean, with the data in this report, we didn't create any of it ourselves. So the data we have, we've got from the Scottish Government or from the enterprise agencies. Some of that is publicly available, and some of that was kind of, I suppose, created by the enterprise agencies for us. We were trying to get data that we could get the same data from both of them, so we could compare like with like. We found that quite difficult at times, but certainly everything that is in this report we obtained from the enterprise agencies. So it might be that you want to direct your questions to the enterprise agencies as to some of that data. Certainly we can provide you with further details of anything that we have in this report, but we did obtain that from the enterprise agencies or the Scottish Government themselves.
And it would be very useful. I would certainly like to see it, because it's a conundrum I think this committee's got to solve in some way, or find out why we can't get information. And so I would refer in particular to your Exhibit 1 on page 9, and then it's coming on from what Jackie already raised, and you talk about productivity, and it's £30.23 an hour in Scotland, compared to £30.97 in the UK as a whole. So my first question is, does that figure actually include, in the UK figure, does that include Scotland? And in the back of that, can you separate Ireland and Wales, which I think might be a better comparator to the UK, and all that goes with that? Or is there a way to kind of, marry up what the shape of the Scottish economy? Would it not be a fairer way to do it, and a more sensible way to do it, rather than compare it with the UK?
I don't have the details of how that data is broken down at the moment, but I can certainly look into it and come back to you with it. What we wanted to do in that kind of exhibit is, I suppose, in one exhibit, show as many kind of key points about the economy as we can, but I can certainly come back to you with the details of exactly what's included and excluded and how it breaks down to see if we can do those comparisons.
I mean, the substance of my question really is this, that here we are, we're comparing Scotland with the United Kingdom, and we know that Black Star's involved in the United Kingdom. That's London. And London, a black hole that just, it disturbs everything that surrounds it, including the whole of England. So therefore, if we're comparing, including in Scotland, England, sorry, Ireland, or the regions of England, and include London, and if you consider the massive subsidies that London enjoys with its infrastructure, that the rest of us have to make a contribution, but we don't see the benefit of that. And of course, one of the biggest ones for an employer is London waiting, and it goes wider than London. So that if we're making a comparison on the figures that's in your report with all that in it, is it a reasonable comparison to make? Should we not be looking at somewhere else? Actually, Scotland, if you take London out of it, might actually be performing extremely well. I don't know, because it's only a comment. There's no way that I can actually determine whether that statement is correct or not.
I think the point I would make, Mr. Patterson, convener, if I may, is that we take as our starting point what are seen to be credible and respected statistics. We tend not to, as Gemma said, create these things ourselves unless we've got a very clear reason to do that, because I think, as this conversation demonstrates, you can get into very big debate about the numbers. So that's why we use places like the Office for National Statistics and other recognised sources, and we report that on. But you raise a good question, and certainly we can come back to the committee with a breakdown of what's involved, particularly in that productivity number. We can give you that.
I think my main point here is that, back to my original question, is that if we don't have figures for Scotland that we can discern, that we can interrogate. How can we possibly, you know, say that these figures are categoric if we can't find them, if they're not there? I'm not blaming you for this, sure, because it's a very, very serious question, particularly at this juncture that Scotland finds itself and the rest of the United Kingdom with regards to Brexit. These questions are quite fundamental to the narrative when it comes to Brexit. And so, therefore, your agency and everybody else is, it's sort of a sailing close to the wind when it comes to the factual results, if we can't actually get figures that are peculiar to Scotland.
I suppose my final comment, convener, would be that it's, you know, that there are lots of ways of cutting the data. I think this touches on your core question, Mr. Patterson. I don't think the problem we have is not enough data. It's the way it's presented and what we do with it and the way in which you can compare it and make sense of it. I think we've got loads of information and loads of data. It's kind of making it usable that's the challenge sometimes. And there are lots of organisations out there in terms of the economy, Fraser of Allender, Mackay Consultants, loads of people doing lots of different kinds of analysis. I'm not sure you will ever get a kind of universally agreed set of figures that everyone's going to sign up to. There's lots of different ways of presenting it. I think, in a sense, what we tried to focus on in this report was not so much those things, because, as I say, we're not economists, but actually trying to make that assessment of the contribution of the agencies, and that's why we decided to focus on those things for this report. Thank you.
Mr. McKinley has said the Audit Scotland will come back to try and give some detail of the figures and where they come from, but I don't think they wish to get involved in the debate of whether or not London is a powerhouse which subsidises the rest of the United Kingdom, or a black hole, as you describe it. I'll move to Dean Lockhart.
Thank you, convener, and thank you for the guests coming along today. In the past decade, the Scottish economy has underperformed the rest of the UK in terms of economic growth, just touching on some of the issues that's been discussed in terms of GDP and employment growth, including, I must say, Wales and Northern Ireland in terms of employment growth. Latest GDP numbers that came out about two weeks ago show that underperformance continues relative to the rest of the UK, and now that the Scottish Parliament has new fiscal powers, according to the Fraser of Allender Institute, the relative underperformance of the Scottish economy will now contribute to the Scottish budget and possibly lower public spending. Could I get your thoughts in terms of your report says the enterprise bodies are performing well, but the Scottish Government needs a clearer plan for delivering its economic strategy. Could you give me a couple of reasons why the Scottish economy is underperforming? What in your mind, and I appreciate this is slightly beyond the scope of the report, but in your mind, why are we underperforming not only the UK, but other small countries in the EU in terms of economic growth?
Convener, if it's okay with you, I might politely sidestep that question, because genuinely that's not a thing that we're just not best placed to do it, I'm afraid. I think the interesting thing about this topic is, and this is why it's such a fascinating piece of work to do, is that if you were to get 10 economists in this room, you would probably get 10 different answers to that question. I don't think Audit Scotland are the best place to add a view.
I can make the question more specific, and thank you, and apologies for making it so broad. Maybe a more specific question. The gap between what the enterprise bodies do and how the 4I economic policy is measured, how do you think that gap is best measured or bridged?
That I can do, Ms. Hartle, thank you. And I'll ask Gemma to come in. So I think the 2015 strategy was obviously revised last year and had a couple of important changes, one of which was the inclusive growth, which has kind of been a theme running through economic policy for a long time, but this was the first time it was included specifically as an objective. And I think what we're saying to give an example is that I don't think at any point the government have specifically said our approach to delivering inclusive growth is X and the role of the agencies in delivering that bit of the strategy is why. The other thing for us which is interesting, and the government I think has been very clear that the four I's are complementary, that they support one another, that inclusive growth is an important element of an investment and investing in other things. And we think sometimes there might be some tensions in there. And I think it's important that the strategy and the plan for delivering the strategy recognises some of the challenges that, again, I think you were talking about last week, before recess, with trade union colleagues about fair work. And the thing that struck me about that conversation was it demonstrated what is quite a fundamental shift in the structure of the economy. The economy is a very different place than it was 10 years ago and will be very different again in 10 or 20 years' time. And our challenge, I suppose, to the government and the agencies is how are you ensuring that the strategy and the plan for delivering that strategy remains fit for purpose, not just for now, but for what the economy is going to look like in 10, 15, 20 years' time.
Okay, thank you.
Andy Whiteman.
Convener, I've got a couple of questions, but I'll just deal with them one at a time. I was interested in paragraph 39 in the report, where you say that all public body spending supports economic growth in some way, both directly and indirectly. There is no agreed definition of economic development activity, which means that the total public sector spending on direct support for economic growth is unknown. You then go on to acknowledge that areas such as education, whose primary purpose is not economic growth, obviously do support it. So you acknowledge there's problems there. The EU Court of Auditors, for example, has identified millions of euros in agricultural subsidies in Scotland that do, to quote from their 2011 audit report, identified beneficiaries up to €1 million per year without having any agricultural activity on such land. Commentators have suggested that 25% or 30% of agricultural subsidies are doing absolutely nothing. So whilst we may have difficulty in identifying the areas that support economic activity, we can certainly potentially identify some areas that are doing absolutely nothing at all in public expenditure. And I was just wondering whether what work needs to be done in your view to get over this very large deficiency that we don't know what public sector spending is doing to support economic growth, and whether we need to do anything about the fact there's no agreed definition of economic development activity.
I'll kick off and I'll ask Anthony to come in if I may. So on the definition front, we are keen that that we understand the definition of economic development to the point that it's useful. So what we're not suggesting is we spend forever doing a kind of academic exercise to come up with a theoretical definition of what it is. We think it's important to define it so that you can then figure out what money's being spent on it, so you can then figure out what difference it's making. And so that, I think, is the job to be done. I mentioned earlier that we try not to invent, but do some analysis and come up with figures of our own. In actual fact, we did do that on this occasion. The 12 billion figure was a bit of analysis that we did at our own hand, and indeed it did prove to be contentious. Because, as you say, there's lots of debate about the extent to which all that money is being spent on economic growth. So absolutely there is a job to be done there. Anthony, I'll ask you to come in on the specifics of what we think should be done.
I think, Mr. Whiteman, this takes us back to an earlier part of the conversation this morning, which is about understanding the contribution that the different bodies are making to supporting Scotland's economic strategy. It's very clear that the money that's spent in schools and universities and colleges, the money that's spent on transport and infrastructure, all make a contribution to supporting economic growth. We don't think it's feasible to try and allocate every pound, shilling and pence to support for the economic strategy. What needs to happen is a better understanding of what alignment and contribution those bodies are making. So it's about having a better understanding of how the university sector, how the colleges sector, how the school sector is supporting and contributing to that broader national strategy for supporting economic growth.
You do make an attempt to come up with a figure there.
We do make an attempt.
My question really is, that's obviously, I think you'd agree, not very satisfactory to have to do that rather crude exercise, albeit I think you were doing it to try and highlight the deficiency. But you say it is unknown. So clearly we need to do something. We don't, as Fraser said, need to do very complex exercises, because this could end up being a very large academic and bureaucratic exercise, but clearly we need something that is makes it easier for those charged with scrutinising public expenditure to be able to come to a reasonable assessment of whether it's supporting economic development or not.
And when Mr. McKinley was responding to Jackie Bailey earlier in terms of the things we'd like to see coming out of the review that's taking place at the moment, I think our assumption is that one of the outcomes of the review might be a better understanding of how the funding that is spent across those various bodies is supporting Scotland's economic strategy. Now, that may well necessarily be relatively high level and have to be underpinned by a load of assumptions, but that seems to us a reasonable step forward compared to where we are at the moment.
Thank you. My second question relates to paragraph 85 on page 34, where you say that Scottish Enterprise and High operate in a high-risk environment. They should only invest when the private sector, including banks or other investors, is unwilling or unable to. When you say they should only invest in those circumstances, is that your opinion?
See something else here. I think that is more supposed to be a statement of fact. That is their job, in a sense.
Okay, I'd be interested to know where you get that from, because clearly the enterprise agencies do invest where the private sector is perfectly willing. I'll give you an example of the support that Highlands and Islands Enterprise give to community land acquisition. There's plenty of people willing to buy that land, but they provide substantial support.
And again, I think there will be lots of reasons why they think that public support is able to do is a good idea there. Mm. So I don't think it's a case of, like all of this, it's never a black and white case of it's only public sector, it's only private sector. There are always going to be grey areas. I think what we're clear about, and to be fair, I think what the agencies are clear about, is that there needs to be a good rationale for why public money in those cases and others is actually going to add value. That's getting to all the technical measurements about additionality and all those kinds of things. They're absolutely clear about that, and that forms part of the evaluation frameworks that the individual bodies have. So when we talk in the report about the role of the individual bodies and them performing relatively well, that includes the fact that they do measure how their investments have done and the extent to which they've met their objectives. So it's not that statement is not meant to be an apology if it reads too much like a black and white, they only do that, or it's either public or private. You know, very often it will be a combination of those things.
Okay, so just to conclude, would you be able to let the committee see the sort of footnote for that, as it were, the basis on which you understand that they should only invest in those circumstances?
So I don't think there'll be a specific reference to it, Ms. Whiteman. I think it comes back to my point I made earlier on, which is the whole point of having state enterprise agencies is to work in a riskier environment where the market isn't on its own going to deal with that.
Correct. I don't think that is the point. I mean, it may or may not be the point. If it is the point, where does any statute or government policy say that's the point? I'm just interested, okay. You know, if you were to footnote that, what would be your evidence for that statement? I accept it in very, very general terms, but, you know, post-war, you know, coal, gas, electricity, trains were not nationalised because the private sector couldn't do it all. They were done for a wide range of reasons, and the public sector has intervened for a wide range of reasons ever since.
Yeah. Sorry, Andy Whiteman's question is, where is the policy guidance, statutory basis or other reason for putting that statement in? Because clearly that, I think that's what you're looking for, is it not?
Mm-hmm. And we can certainly go and dig that out. I guess I'm hesitating slightly because I'm just we'll just need to double check that it is written down in those terms somewhere, and it may be that the way we've written that is more categorical than it should be. But we can certainly go and double check and come back to the committee, Mr. Whiteman. Certainly. Thanks.
Thank you. Gillian Martin.
Yeah, I'd like to bring it back to the support for businesses. You make one of your key messages, the number four in your key messages, starts with the full range of public sector support for businesses is not known, which creates a risk of duplication and inefficiency, that's one point. And second point there, public sector support is not well understood by businesses and there's scope to simplify. Could you give me some of the background as to why you made that statement and what investigation you did to come up with that analysis?
Sure. Again, I'll ask Gemma to talk to the detail, but part of it was from talking to businesses And we always try and in this this report was no different, that we went out and spoke to businesses both. We tried to engage with business generally, which proved tricky. But we also spoke specifically to businesses that are account managed and others that have had experience of working with the agencies. And one of the messages we got back was it's quite a complicated landscape out there. We haven't focused on, for example, the role of local government and councils in all of this, but business gateways are another important part of the landscape. And I think what we're saying here is that if you put yourself in the shoes of a small business owner, it's quite a complicated landscape, and there's maybe some things we can do to help simplify that. Gemma, do you want to add to that a bit?
Absolutely. So we look, for example, the government have tried to kind of consolidate all the websites that were there for supporting businesses into the mygov.scot, but even that has over 600 different funding streams available for business, so it is a very complicated landscape for somebody to try and navigate their way through. Certainly when we looked at sector support for the food and drink sector and also for the energy sector, there was a wide range of different funding streams from different bodies with different criteria. And it's, again, difficult to know whose door do you knock on, and if you knock on that door and get refused, do you necessarily know that there's somewhere else to go? And certainly there'd been a recent review done of the food and drink sector, and they couldn't identify all the money that was spent in supporting that sector. So I think what we're trying to say is that there needs to be a better understanding and more, I suppose, rationale of trying to rationalise all those different funding streams and to make it very clear that there's one route in for businesses, and then there will be clear signposting between that. And we think that there's more that can be done on that to make it easier for businesses to get that support.
And did you identify, or did you speak to people who were like starting out in business as well when you were doing that investigation? I mean,
what we did was we generally spoke to businesses that had support from Scottish Enterprise and Highlands and Islands Enterprise. We also spoke to business representative organisations. We didn't get involved with the business gateway side of things, which is where some of those smaller businesses would have their first engagement. That was outside of the scope of this report, just to try and keep it manageable. But we did speak to the FSB, for example, about some of the issues they encounter. So we tried to get as wide a range of opinion as we can, understanding that the business community is very large. There's, you know, lots of different types of businesses, and they'll have lots of different opinions on the types of support that are out there. But from the opinions that we gathered and from looking into ourselves, those were the conclusions that we had.
Very briefly to add, Camille, on one of our learning points from doing this report actually was at the outset we tried a social media campaign to engage the business community in general, and which is something that we struggled with, and it's fair to say wasn't an overwhelming success. So there's something for us to reflect on there about how we do get access to, speak to, engage with business owners and companies that aren't already in the system, if you know what I mean, and which we can get at quite easily. So that's something that we're reflecting on for future work.
I mean, the reason I'm asking is at the moment I'm from the northeast. We find quite a lot of people are starting up businesses as a result of maybe being made redundant from oil and gas. And I've been spending a lot of time, particularly with women starting up in business in my area as well. And it seems to me that section, that the potential business people of the future who are not quite there yet, don't know how to access any of the help. Was that something that you looked at?
Not directly. I think, as Gemma said, we would expect them to come through the business gateway route. But I think it does touch on the point we make in the report about, while we focused on Scottish Enterprise and High, we also recognise that there are lots of other bodies at play here, councils, colleges, universities, other things, which, again, you might expect to be helping those people who are, for lots of reasons, designed to embark on their own, on a new career or build a new business. So that, again, is why it's important that there is that sense of coherence around the public sector partners, that this is part of everyone's job. And if you happen to be coming across somebody like that in a different context, that they're also able to think about providing some advice and guidance, or at least some signposting to the right place to go. So I think there's that sense of joined upness is exactly what we're looking for, and it'll be interesting to see if the review touches on some of that.
Thanks, that's very helpful.
Thank you. I'd like to bring in the other members of the committee, and perhaps in light of time constraints, if they could make their questions brief, sharp, to the point, and perhaps the best question, Liam Kerr.
The best question out of four. Right, thanks, convener. I just want to take on Gillian Martin's point at the outset. Just in terms of, because I noticed at page 18, paragraph 36, you talked about that the agencies had tried to identify the 600 funding streams, the public support that's available, but abandoned it because it was too complex. So Gemma Diamond said something needs to be done, more can be done. But if even the agencies can't get through this, what practically can be done, or indeed is being done, and by whom?
I think what we would recommend is that, yes, an attempt was made, but it was abandoned, I suppose, at quite an early stage. And I think what we're saying is actually that this is a problem that is worthy of more investigation, and then it's not a case of actually accepting that, yes, there is that many funding streams, and yes, it's complicated, but it's too complicated and we can't do anything about it. I think what we're saying is here is actually it's worthy of further investigation, it's worthy of further work, it's worthy of looking to see actually, can we map this out? Can we simplify it? Can we make it easier? And I think what we're doing is providing that push to say, actually, please, can you carry on with that work?
I just checked, and I think our guests are able to stay for slightly longer than we'd scheduled for till, say, quarter two, which will give us a bit more time for those still wishing to ask questions. So perhaps, Liam Kerr, if you wanted to follow up on one of those points. Thank you.
I thought Andy Whiteman made an interesting point, and around the same area, paragraph 87, you've talked about there's a return on investment of about 20% and write-offs of about £39 million on these investments. Do you have any view on whether that's good value to the public purse?
It's not an assessment we've done as part of this work, Mr. Kerr. Is the short answer. I mean, this is in a sense that gets to the heart of the conversation we were just having with Mr. Whiteman about what the job of an enterprise agency is. I think what's where we get some assurance is that the systems around this whole area of what's invested and what's written off and all that is well governed. So the measurement systems that they have in place within the agencies are, we think, sound. The judgment of value for money is a notoriously difficult one to make because you would need to bring in opportunity costs, and if we hadn't invested it in that, could we have invested it in something else? And there is a whole system and assessment process that the agencies go through to make those judgments. It's hard for us to second guess that, I think.
Thank you. Gordon MacDonald.
A couple of quick points. First one is, on paragraph 45 on page 21, you talk about city-region deals. And with the growth of the city-region deals, I think the six you've indicated are going to be taking part, are certainly being considered in Scotland at the moment. I'm just wondering what impact the growth of city-region deals has on the role and the remit of the enterprise agencies, given that city-region deals give those areas the opportunity to set their own investment priorities?
Great question. And I think one of the reasons we say that the government and agencies need to continually look at the changing environment is I think city deals and growth deals are a great example of that. They are a relatively new phenomenon. They are quite complex. The funding comes from lots of different places. There is risk involved for lots of parties. Because a lot of my work is with councils, and certainly for the councils involved, in some ways city deals and growth deals, regional deals, are the biggest show in town at the moment in terms of this stuff. So there is a real need, I think, for the agencies to consider and set out more clearly what their role is in these things, and is it the same everywhere? So is there involvement in Glasgow city region deal the same as the Inverness and the Highlands regional deal, for example? Is a great example, I think, of how the world is changing quite fast, and need therefore for the strategy, the plan, and the contribution of the agencies to be more clearly set out.
Is there a, do you have a particular view about what that role should actually be?
We don't at the moment, and nor is it for us necessarily to have that role. I think what's important is, my guess is, it won't be a one-size-fits-all. I would imagine that the contribution that HIE make to the Highland Regional Growth Deal will be different to the one that SE makes to Glasgow or the Ayrshires or the Fife and Lothian's version of that, because the whole point of those regional deals is that they are themselves all quite different. And so I think what's important is that the agencies have an approach that identifies what best contribution they can make, if indeed they make any contribution at all.
And going back to the subject of data, I know everybody's touched upon this, but given the UK situation in terms of size in comparison to Scotland, are there any European nations of a similar size to Scotland that we should be looking at to see where good practice is in terms of how their enterprise agencies work?
Gemma, do you want to take
it? Actually, that is something that the review has been considering. They recently published some work that they'd undertaken, research that looked at the arrangements in other countries. So we certainly would look to see how that's taken forward as part of the review.
My last point in terms of the data, you've made comparisons about Scotland and the rest of the UK. Would it not be more helpful that if you published the 12 regions of the UK that ONS put in to see actually where Scotland sits, rather than this very blunt comparison with the rest of the UK? An example I'll give is the House of Commons Library produced at the end of August the regional and local economic growth stats for 2010 to 2014. And if you exclude London, which is obviously skews everything in the UK, you find that Scotland, out of the other 11 regions of the UK, is actually in fourth place in terms of growth between 2010 and 2014. Now, that surely is a better way of presenting the figures, showing it in context of all of the regions of the UK to see exactly where we are, rather than this very blunt, here's a UK figure that is skewed by London compared to Scotland.
I guess that those numbers, Gordon, will include an oil price.
No, it doesn't. Yes. But sorry, I'm asking the witnesses.
Yes.
Asking the questions at the minute.
So I think it's very helpful feedback, and we'll reflect on that for the next time round. I think it's important to say that the reason that we included those figures was just to give some kind of context. But your point, and in future we can certainly look at introducing some different measures on the basis that, as I said earlier on, I'm not sure we're going to get to an agreed set of numbers, but I think your feedback is very helpful. Thank you.
Okay, thanks so much.
I suppose your difficulty in that may be that if one looks at specific areas such as the North East, the oil industry, takes London out, looks at Birmingham, you could look at a whole variety of different areas that are very different. Is that something that really is part of your remit?
So I think that's the point I've been trying to make, which is our starting point is well-recognised and well-used figures. And for the purposes of this exercise, in terms of setting context, the UK comparison was the kind of most straightforward, I guess, to get in a report. But I do take the point that there are other measures available, and I guess all I'm saying is we'll certainly consider that in future.
Right. Thank you. Richard Leonard.
Mr. McKinley, earlier on you described the case studies as colour in the report, and I wonder whether you could perhaps reflect on the colour that was sparked by the investment in Amazon at Dunfermline, when in 2013, I think it was revealed that it received £2.5 million of Scottish Government investment in the same year that it paid corporation tax of £2.4 million. On a turnover of over £4 billion. So I guess my question is, do you think that represents a sensible route of investment for the public purse? And secondly, you mentioned as well earlier on Fair Work as a growing part of the consideration of economic development. And of course, Amazon is notorious for being an employer which has used zero-hours contracts extensively, is not, as I understand it, a living wage employer, and which refuses to recognise trade unions. So it wouldn't qualify for the Scottish Business Pledge, I don't suppose. Do you have a view on that?
So again, you might be not surprised to say not directly, but what I would say is that I think the Amazon is a good example, a good case study of, and it's worth bearing in mind that very often these big inward investments are a competitive process, and there were other places who were looking for Amazon to invest, and so at that point, and genuinely, I make no comment about some of the points you made there, Mr. Leonard, in terms of Amazon as a business, but the judgment that I guess Scottish Enterprise and the government are making is if we don't support it, they might go somewhere else, is part of the judgment that they have to make. Your second point about fair work, I think there is an interesting question there. I mentioned earlier on about the inclusive growth part of the strategy, and I mentioned some potential tensions, and I think those kinds of examples are one where in future, and this is why it's important that the enterprise agencies are absolutely crystal clear about what their role is in terms of inclusive growth and fair work, because as these kind of opportunities present themselves, the fair work and inclusive growth bit needs to be an important part of that consideration. I genuinely have no comment as to whether it was or it wasn't with Amazon or them as an employer, but it does need to be in future. If the government have said inclusive growth is one of the four equal strands of the strategy, then that needs to feed through into how everyone does their work, including making those kind of decisions to support inward investment like Amazon and others.
But you're not saying, are you, that that would make Amazon or an equivalent in the future ineligible for support?
No, I'm not saying that, because I genuinely have no idea.
Convener, could I just ask one other question on a different point, but it's the one that you raise in paragraph 30, although I'm not sure it finds its way into your final list of recommendations. But you do observe, when you're discussing the strategic forum, that no details of the strategic forum are publicly available, including its remit, how often it meets and what it discusses. There are also no details of the impact it has had on collaborative working. In light of those comments, do you have any recommendations about the strategic forum?
That's a very fair question. And yes, I suppose I would say that if the strategic forum is a thing that's genuinely supposed to be making a difference to how this works, then it should be more transparent, it should be clearer, we should have a better sense of the job it plays. I think at the moment our sense was that the role of the forum was a bit unclear. It was a kind of place where people can get together and share some stuff. So I think there is something about if it is to be a decision-making forum or an engine for some of this stuff, then it needs to be kind of given the weight that would bring with it.
It's a body chaired by a cabinet secretary, isn't it?
It is, yeah.
Yeah. Thank you.
May I just clarify, are you saying that as something that you would now recommend or something you would want to look at and come back to us along with the other issues that have been raised that you will come back to us on?
Yeah, very happy.
I'm just thinking there may be some parameters for the strategic forum guidelines or something. I don't know that you would want to look at before you commit to some particular recommendation. Or are you happy to commit to a particular recommendation here and now?
I think when we were making our recommendations, we were conscious of the fact that those weaknesses of the strategic forum. I think in making our recommendations and going forward into the review, that what we didn't want to do was to narrow essentially who might be in the strategic forum in the future. For example, I think that is all going to be considered as part of the view, is who are the key bodies that are charged with supporting Scotland's economic growth, who should be in that strategic forum and what should it do. So essentially we made those wider recommendations acknowledging those weaknesses but not making any specific recommendations about the strategic forum until we know what the outcome of the review is and how that might look in the future. So we didn't really want to, I suppose, narrow the options of the government in making those recommendations.
I suppose, if I may, it would fall under monitoring and reporting progress, which is one of your recommendations, because, as has been pointed out, if there is no transparency about the strategic forum, then it can hardly be monitored.
And, as Gemma says, I think the review is also a good opportunity for them to look at the role of the strategic forum, so I would have it under that recommendation as well.
Re- Did you want to come back on that, Richard, or?
No, it's fine. It's fine.
Thank you. I'll move then to Ash Denham.
I just wanted to pick up on a theme that emerged earlier. So in your report, you've said that the development agencies are performing well against their own performance measures, and they account for only 2% of public sector spending. So I think my point here is that we need to be quite realistic then about what can be achieved by these development agencies. In your report, you've said that measuring their contribution to economic growth is difficult, and you've stated a number of reasons for those, so things like time lag, isolating the influence, and then other factors like what's happening in the global economy as well. So it seems to me then that it'd be quite unreasonable to expect the development agencies to be able to have any radical effect on the Scottish economy. But you have said that you felt that there was a lack of ability to measure the development agency's contribution to the national performance framework. And obviously these are two different things. So in paragraph 27, you said that you've looked at other countries' approaches to supporting economic growth. So I suppose my question is, have other countries solved this problem of measuring the performance of development agencies and their support against very high-level performance indicators like the national performance framework?
I don't think we found anywhere that we would say they've absolutely cracked it. I think Northern Ireland, it seemed to us, was as good an example as we found of taking a high-level strategy and underpinning it with clearer timescales, clearer actions, responsibilities for organisations that can then be measured. As I said earlier, accepting the fact that the outcomes bit will be long-term in nature, it's absolutely reasonable for people to expect there to be some interim measures that allows us to know whether we're on track or not. And as you say, recognising that there are lots of other things at play in the economy that that you can't just draw a straight line that if the agencies perform well, the Scottish economy will perform well. It's clearly not that straightforward. But you would expect them to have some kind of impact and some kind of influence on it. And I think being clear about the roles, being clear about how they're doing it and how they're spending their money. And as you say, that's why we felt it was important not while we focus mainly on the two agencies, we also made the attempt to look at the wider agencies in the strategic forum, which spend 2.2 billion, and that's why we then made the wider assessment of the 12 billion that you could say was directed towards economic growth, recognising that the wider you draw the circle, the more complex that gets. And that's why, as Anthony said earlier on, that it's the alignment that's important to all of that. The recommendation we make actually in the report, specifically around the money, is about estimating, it's top of page 7, estimating the total spending on the four strategic priorities. So I think what we're suggesting is rather than starting with how much money each body spends, start with the priorities and say, well, how much money is contributing to those things, which will inevitably come from lots of different places. And we think starting with from that end of the telescope, if you like, you've got a better chance of coming up with a meaningful set of numbers that that we can actually do something with.
Okay, thank you very much. We'll just thank our guests for coming today. Thank you very much. And I'll suspend this meeting, move to private session, and allow a few minutes for the gallery to clear of any visitors who are there. Thank you very much.